We have written a conference entitled The Need of a System Applied in Church Missions. I will just talk to you a little bit about systems, just as an introduction. And then we will see how systems will work in three different aspects that we need to do the work of God, which is discipline, unity, and financial management. So for today, I'll give you the introduction, which is the need of a system applied in church missions, and we'll enter into discipline, the role of discipline in developing missionary work. And then tomorrow, please God, we'll see how systems may be applied in unity, which is so important as well to develop a work for the Lord. And then on the last day, please God, we purpose to speak about financial management in missions. All these three subjects are really important for us. Now I just want to start with this introduction. What is a system? A system is a collection of components or parts that interact together for a common purpose. Again, a system is a collection of components or parts that interact together for a common purpose. But a system is not just an old collection of components or components. The parts are related in such a way that each depends on the others to do whatever job there is to be done. So it means the parts cannot work alone. Every component or part of the system must work together so that the job can be done. And no single part can do the job alone, and any malfunction or delay is likely to affect the whole system. So if there is one of the parts of the system that wants to do the job alone, it will cause the whole system to be affected. It means results will not come out as we want. A body system is a set of body parts. We are speaking now about the body. A body system is a set of body parts that do a particular task. We're speaking about your body, my body. The human body itself is an example of a complex system. Many sets of interacting parts that work to keep the human machine running. So our body is not just a single system, it's a complex system. Is composed by different systems, and just a system in itself is composed by different parts, and they must work together that the whole system works. But the body itself is composed by so many different systems that work together that the whole machine, human machine, may work properly. So it's not that simple as we look at it. Because our body, we say our body, or you say my body, is yours. We are so accustomed to my body that we don't realize how complex it is and how many systems work together in harmony so that the whole machine may do things that look so simple, like to walk. That looks simple, but it's not that simple. When we are born, we don't know how to walk. And we must learn how to walk. And somebody must teach us how to walk. And how to coordinate all the systems inside ourselves so that we may do something as simple as to walk. Let us speak about this. On one single day, on any single day, pay attention to this. We can estimate that your heart beats 103,689 times. Just on any single day. 103,689 times. Too much. But the most interesting thing is that the heart will start beating when we are formed in our mother's womb and will never stop until the day you are done. Hallelujah. So it means every single day will be like that, never stopping, because the system and the complexity of different systems working together will keep you going on like that. The other thing that I really was amazed when I studied this is concerning the blood. Listen to this. Listen to this. Your blood travels 168 million miles, or in other words, 270,000 miles, or excuse me, kilometers a day, every 24 hours. Again, because maybe this shocking, you get like this. What? Yes, your blood travels on a single day 168 million miles, or 270,000 kilometers. Every 24 hours. That much, Pastor? That's not my fault. Don't look at me in that strange way. That's not my fault. That is your body. Now, taking into account that the average distance from the earth to the sun is 93 million miles, it means 150 million kilometers, then it means that our blood on a single day can almost go on a round trip to the sun. every 24 hours. For sure, your blood goes from here to the sand and comes back and almost complete the trip on a single day, every 24 hours. When I studied this, I was like, what? But that is not my fault. That is your body. Why do I say these things? It's just for us to understand, how is it possible? Because there are some different systems working together perfectly day by day to achieve, or in other words, to do the job. Had you ever thought about your body like that? Not me. I was amazed when I started studying. I said, Lord, to go to the sun and come back in a single day? Yes. It means we can achieve a lot when we understand and enter into our place that the work of God can be accomplished. We could do much more than we think. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, your digestive system processes 7.8 pounds of waste a day. There was a time when I wanted to just take an average. I better said no, I won't continue. Because to speak about all these things and put it for a whole life, a lifetime, there are no words to see how you can understand the achievements through your body, and we consider it simple because it is designed and made by the hand of God. Designed and made by the hand of God. And he put together some different systems so that this thing may be done on a daily basis. And then I'm just trying to put this thing inside you to understand that we are the body of Jesus. That we could travel from here to the sun and come back in a single day if possible. To do missions, to do the work of God, to reach the lost, to do something for the glory of God. Come on, you can do it. You can do it. Pastor, let us open our eyes. We can do a lot. We are the body of Jesus. And if all the things are in place, if I am in place and you're in place and everybody else in place, we could do a lot. We could travel to the sun every day and come back. It's just an imaginary way. It's my style to speak. We can do a lot. Different organs functioning together as systems. For example, the respiratory system consists of the nose, pharynx, larynx, trachea, bronchi, and lungs. This is for the respiratory system. It is one system. The parts of this respiratory system work together to take in the oxygen we need to survive and to get rid of the carbon dioxide. So the respiratory systems will work all of these things. Just for you to know how many air our system processes in a day, I will tell you that your lungs take in 12,400 liters of air a day. Every 24 hours, it means 3,276 gallons. Huge tank. Every day. Every day. While speaking, while eating, while sleeping, while bathing, while doing everything, you continue. You never stop. But not only take in, but it processes that air and takes the oxygen and expels the carbon dioxide, which is not good for the body. And this process on a daily basis, thousands and thousands of gallons, every day, tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, and then again, and it will never stop. The day you stop breathing, you stop being. Amen. So all this just to show you that we can do much more than we think. That just a single body can do all these things. Let us say that we all are the body, because we are the body of Jesus. We could breathe much more than we are doing it now. Amen. Let's breathe Holy Spirit into our lives. Hallelujah. Let's breathe Holy Spirit. For breakfast, morning time, lunch time, evening time, for dinner, while sleeping, while bathing, while walking, while singing, breathe Holy Spirit. Breathe Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. We can do much more. Are you with me this morning? I say we can do much more. Many, many times we are so wrong. Because when we do a little thing for the work of God and for the glory of the Lord, like if the church is 300, 500, or if we went here or there and we preach in the morning, in the evening, or if we saw maybe 50 people coming, accepting Jesus, so we are so glad and we know. I feel myself, oh, now I am the top man of the city. Now I am the top preacher of the country. Now I am the top minister in the worldwide missionary movement. That is nothing. Yes. That is nothing. We are just starting to learn how to breathe. Breathe. Breathe more. How many of you want to breathe more? How many of you want to breathe more? Breathe more Holy Spirit in your life. Well, I want to finish this. It's just introduction. Eh? Sorry for that, but I am always like that. I get excited when I start thinking about the greatness of the Lord in ourselves. To understand this, we will see why systems are necessary, especially in the work of God. First, and I will try to go faster now. First, because systems will help you to define procedures for every activity and process in a specific project. Will help you to define what is your part in the whole machine. Amen. That you are not the machine, you are a part of the machine. That systems will help you to define, to understand that you are just a part in the machine. Do you have a specific task? I cannot sing as good as some of the singers that are singing or will sing afterwards. I cannot sing like that. I sing just at home. Sometimes in church, when I make the altar call, then I will sing for people to come. That's it. I know. They will help you to keep track of the details. The work that must be done has a lot of details. When we implement a system, we start getting aware of the details. We see the whole thing, but we must understand the details, because that is necessary for us to keep the system going on. Third, the systems will help you to leverage your time and be more productive. In other words, system will help us to spend our time in a much wiser time. In other words, we will learn how to use our time. Because we can do a lot of things and spend a lot of time, but sometimes spinning around always and not getting any result. When we get a system, we learn how to leverage our time and be more productive. It means we learn how to use our time so that we don't continue spinning around with no results. Amen. The other thing is that they will help you to communicate properly and appropriately within the different departments of the project. Sometimes the most difficult thing within a team is communication. It's so easy to speak, it's so hard to communicate. Can I tell you that truth again? It is so easy to speak, it is so hard to communicate. Okay, I don't want to stop much because I need to go on. Systems will help you maintain an accurate picture of the financial position of the project. This is a critical part of any project. Finances are necessary as well. And systems will help you to keep the right picture, to know exactly how this financial thing is going on. And then you will know exactly what do we have, the things that we must pay attention to, how much money we have for this and for that. And without that, with the same amount of money, many people will destroy a company. And with that, someone without no money will build a company. Maybe you don't understand me, but administration is so important. And we'll speak about it on the last day. It means Monday morning, we'll speak about this, financial administration. A bad manager, you will give him a whole company, he will destroy it. A good manager, you give him a broken company and he will build it. I know a little bit. The other thing is, system will allow you to share the workload of the project. The workload of the project. It means that a lot of work, but sometimes we could just put the whole load of the work on one person, and the other ones, they are not working. They want to work, but they don't have the opportunity. They don't find a place. They cannot fit in. But systems will help us to share the workload. So then you will be sitting when you have to sit, but somebody else will be doing this, somebody else will be doing that, somebody else will be doing that, somebody else will be doing that, and then the workload is shared and the whole system is going to work and the results much better. And just to finish, they will save you time. Systems will save you time. And we'll avoid burnout. You know what burnout is? When you say, cannot make it, I'm done. That is when we are burnout. Cannot make it because I'm done. No strength. No vision now. Maybe you need some vitamins. Something else. Or maybe you could go out there, take the wires of the public power, electricity, 220, hold them until you get something. Maybe you get some power too. But you understand what I mean, okay? So therefore, what I want to say is the concept of a system can also be applied to church missions, to discipline, unity, and financial management in order to be fruitful in the missions. That's why I told you now we'll enter into the role of discipline in developing missionary work now. And we hope we'll finish speaking about this today. And tomorrow, please God, then we'll go with unity. And Monday, please God, we'll go with financial management in missions. These 3 points. Now, let's enter discipline. There are normally 2 kinds of discipline we could follow. 2 kinds. If you find all these definitions strange, don't worry. They are not taken out from any book. We are not studying books to give these conferences. We are studying the Word of God. So if the definition is strange for you, don't worry. Just grasp whatever you need. There are normally 2 kinds of disciplines we could follow. First one, imposed discipline. Is the discipline somebody or an institution impose on a person to fit in or to keep a good standard? Is the discipline that somebody or an institution will impose on you or on a person to fit in or to keep a good standard? That discipline will work while the person or institution that controls discipline is present. In other words, that discipline looks good but has a problem. What is the problem? That it only works until the moment that the person or the institution imposing you the discipline is present. Can I give you a little example? We worldwide missionary movement are well known for our inner and outer holiness standards. Even if you don't say amen. Even if you don't say amen. Worldwide missionary movement, we are well known for our inner and outward holiness standards. So it is supposed that all the churches and all the pastors are keeping holiness right through. But somehow you will see that some people who are not with us any longer, in just 1 month, in less than a month, the whole appearance changes. It means it was imposed discipline. Someone was imposing the discipline on them. The person or the institution imposing the discipline is not there, that discipline will not work anymore. That is why I call it not only imposed discipline, but I call this that this is outward discipline. It comes from outside. It comes from outside. It doesn't come from the inside. It comes from outside, someone else. Same thing happens with many people at their job, the company. While the supervisor is there checking his in, everybody's working hard. Suddenly the supervisor has to do something else. He goes, turns and goes to the office, and immediately you will see people. Why? It was imposed discipline. Once the person or the institution who imposes the discipline is not there, it will not work anymore. I call that imposed discipline or outward discipline. Comes from outside. Then there is another kind of discipline. Self-discipline. Self-discipline. It is a gained ability to obey rules or orders which allow you to persevere steadily in a course of action, a purpose, a state, etc., especially in spite of difficulties, obstacles, or discouragement. So, it is not from outside. It's a gained ability. You gained the ability. It's not imposed. You gained the ability to obey rules or orders that allow you to persevere steadily in a course of action, in a purpose, in a state, etc., especially in spite of difficulties, obstacles, or discouragement. Because when we study, we'll see that these things will necessarily come on your way. You cannot avoid that. Obstacles, difficulties, you cannot avoid them. You cannot avoid discouragement, opposition, persecution. All these things will come on your way. But self-discipline is a gained ability that will help you to persevere steadily in a course of action that you will continue doing, persevering in spite of the obstacles, the difficulties, and so on. Psalm 27:4 says, "One thing have I desired of the Lord, and this will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple." Come on, do you know that verse? "One thing have I desired of the Lord, and this will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple." But if you notice that verse speaking about self-discipline, it says, look at it, it says, "One thing have I desired of the Lord." It means I prayed to the Lord about it. But then it says, "And this will I seek after." It means self-discipline. Not only I asked the Lord, I'm doing my best. that I may be in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. You can know people who pray and pray and pray and pray and pray and pray about it. Lord, help me to be in your house. Lord, help me to be in your house. Lord, help me to be in your house. Lord, take me to your house. Lord, I want to be in your house, but they never come to the house. Self-discipline. Or, let us put another example. Lord, help me to yield more fruits. Lord, help me to yield more fruits. Lord, help me to yield more fruits. Lord, help me to be fruitful. Lord, I want to reach the lost for you. Lord, but never reach anybody. They never go out. They never take a tract. They never go to any neighborhood. They never go to any person. They never do anything. Self-discipline means it is a gained ability to obey rules. It's inside. And I will call that self-discipline. The Lord teaches us discipline in every area of life. I will show you some areas and I will try to run in these areas. First, the Lord teaches discipline to study His Word. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 6, and maybe to 8 and 9, it says, "And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart, and you shall teach them diligently unto your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you get up. You shall bind them for a sign upon your hand. They shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them upon the post of thy house and of your gates." So the Lord teaches us discipline. He says, come on, you want my word? He says, okay, you talk about it when you sit in your house. Talk about them when you walk on the way with your children. You teach them to your children. You write them in the walls. You write them in the post of your house. You take them in your hand. You put it here. He said, come on, do something about it. Discipline to study the word. Discipline to pray. Luke 18:1 says, "And he spoke a parable unto them, to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint." And then you know the parable. The parable is that there was a poor widow woman there just crying and weeping because there was a judge which was ungodly. He didn't want to pay attention to anybody. And the woman used to come every day. "Please, I need you to do something for me. Work on my case, please. I have a problem. Today, tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, the whole week, next week, the whole month," until this man said, "I'm up to here. Cannot take it anymore. This woman is taking me to a place that I cannot stand. I will attend to her voice." The Lord says that's the way we should pray. Today, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, every day. So let's say, for instance, that we are praying for Venezuela. Lord, help us in Venezuela. But here today, in the morning, Lord, you know, here Venezuela, please. And tomorrow, Lord, we are living in Venezuela. So you know, Lord, the day after tomorrow, Lord, I am in Venezuela. Remember Venezuela, Lord. And then the whole week and the next week and the next year, discipline. I'm praying for Venezuela until Venezuela gets what we are asking for. Because many times we don't have that self-discipline to pray for something until we get it. And that is what the Lord is saying. Because sometimes we say, I will not pray anymore. I've been praying for 3 whole years and nothing has happened, then I will not pray it more. But the Lord says, you keep on doing it. Keep on doing it. Keep on doing it. Do it over and over and over and over and over and over again. Amen. That is, he will teach us discipline to attend to the house of God. He will teach us discipline to keep our home. Well, he will teach us discipline for everything. I will just give you some verses. For instance, discipline to attend his house. Hebrews 10:35 says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another. And so much the more as you see the day approaching. So the Lord is always telling us, come on, come on. You must do it, do it. Discipline, discipline, discipline. Our God is a God of discipline. Are you with me this morning? Our God is a God of discipline. Sometimes we start evangelizing somebody or evangelizing a town and we quit so fast. But if we keep on doing it, keep on doing it, keep on doing it, keep on doing it, keep on doing it. In due time, the word of God says, if you work, you will harvest. But you need self-discipline. It's not outward discipline, self-discipline. Amen. Praise God. How many of you love the word of God? I think I will give a chance now, pastors from Bucaramanga. Some of our pastors, they are studying English here. We got a special plan for pastors. And now we got a group of about, how many pastors? How many pastors? 18 pastors and pastors' wives. And they are studying English now. Maybe they are not yet speakers, let's speak so long, but they are studying. And they are improving. And they are progressing. And I want them to come in front. Let our pastors and pastors' wives sing a song that you and I may say, yes, it is possible. Discipline, 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 discipline. Yes, it is possible. It is possible. Discipline and more discipline. Every day, tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, every day. You see all these pastors? Maybe you feel strange. You say, they are not that young. You don't need to be young. You don't need to be old. You need to have discipline. And pray to the Lord. The Lord will bless you. And they are going to sing in English. Amen. Pastors are going to sing in English. Even we have some presbyters here. You say, what? Yes, pastors are the one beating the drums, playing the bass guitar, playing the keyboard, singing. Why not? Amen. And they are the ones singing for the glory of God. Presbyters, pastors, pastors' wives, hallelujah. Every one of them. Are you ready, pastors? Everyone ready? These people want to hear you. Are you ready? Not feeling nervous at all. No, not nervous. They say a little bit nervous. But they are going to do it. Amen. Amen.
Okay. God bless you, everybody. God bless you. This is a good day that Jesus gave us. Amen. I have a little nervous. Little. No more. I want to greet Pastor Samuel, Pastor Walter here present with us, Pastor Pedro Coronado, Pastor Obed Mora. I greet Pastor Nathanael Cooper and Alex Ortega and family. Welcome here, pastors. I want to greet all the pastors here present. I want to greet and a special greeting to the all the Church of Christ. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. So we are a group of pastors that started to learn English in February this year. And today we want praise to learn. So please praise the Lord with us. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I will enter His gates with a thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts.
Glory, hallelujah. Jesus, I'm so glad.
So glad.
Set me free.